OTEP community, welcome back to the Philippe Matthews Show Live. Thank you for tuning in wherever you are around the world. I hope that you are safe and that you are sound. And if you are not sound, you are going to be sound tonight, because we're going to have a conversation that we've been needing to have for quite some time. And that is, how can hip hop save African-Americans? How can it heal us? How has it healed us? And how has it gotten us through some of our worst times in life? And so as a result, I wanted to put together an eclectic panel
put together
all age ranges. And so what we did is that we've got Brother B-Man, Billy Bird at the top. We've got Brian Jazzy Beano, because I was corrected. Brother Jazzy Beano. We've got Brother Charlie Hobbs back with us. Lord Jamar is with us. And hey. Young Ghetto Dro is here as well. And Brother La of Underground Music. Hotep to the panel.
Hotep, brothers.
So this is going to be an amazing conversation. Because I'm going to, of course, start with you, Lord Jamar. How has hip-hop saved your life and helped your life during some of the times that you were coming up?
Well, hip-hop that that existed when I was coming up, which I feel is different than what people are calling hip-hop now.
Yes.
It saved my life and affected my life because it was a mentor in a way. Sometimes good, sometimes bad. But definitely a lot more balanced than it is now. You know, I can remember some of my earliest hip hop people like Spoonie G, you know, kind of taught me how to deal with women or just deal with people who might want you for material things. Called Love Rap, and he just talks about people hanging around you for different reasons. You know, you got this and not got that, but when you broke, you know what I mean, everybody's gone type of situation. It also helped me because it gave me it made me say, yeah, now that's something I can do. It gave me inspiration. It gave me that feeling like, yeah, I can actually do something without being, you know, in sports or singing and dancing in the traditional sense, like a Michael Jackson type of choreographed dancing and, you know, singing where you're hitting notes. It's just like fuck singing. So, I just felt like, yo, this is something that I can actually do. So it gave me inspiration. And then certain groups, you know, as rap developed and got more into conscious realms, certain groups inspired that side of me to be more consciously aware, or at least take more pride in that aspect of myself, because I was learning that stuff anyway, like it's out in the world. So yeah, that's what I think. That's what it did for me back then.
I appreciate that. Baba Jamar. Now, Billy Bird, let me ask you the same question. How throughout your life, we're all some of us are around the same age. We, you know, this is the generation that invented and created hip hop, right? So there would be no hip hop culture if it were not for this generation. So it's really important to have an understanding of how important the culture is, the art form is to us. Now, we're also going to get into what does that look like? How has it changed? What's the difference between hip hop and rap? But for now, let's have the conversation. How has it healed you and worked with you and helped you get through some of your tough times throughout your life, Brother B-Man?
Well, looking at the panel, I guess I feel like I'm the old goat on this one, but I guess coming from Brooklyn, New York, and growing up in the Bushwick Projects, probably in the early 70s, across the street from the projects was this park, PS 257. And I used to watch, shout out to Howie J and the Jemison family, Mrs. Jemison, they were always good to me. Howie J and them would set up the two turntables. They would move the panel from the street lights and hook the power cord up. And it became what I would consider to be a festival. Because once they cranked up, you could hear that music reverberating through all eight of the project buildings that are 20 stories high with 10 apartments on each floor.
Wow.
And so for me, that was consumed us, man, because the music was everywhere. Everybody was coming there. Kind of where I live, I call it Project City in a way, because it's the Bushwick Projects. Where I was, right up the block was the brothers from the Sumner Projects, the Tompkins Projects, the Marcy Projects, Cooper. Everybody came there. And so now you had this group of everyone who was out there having a good time. But like anything else, we had all our different groups. You know, you had the straight hoodie hood, stick up kid, knockout kids that would be at the giant dice game. And then you would have the B-boy dancing. And I kind of fit into that area where we would be in there, you know, break dancing and jumping and hopping and, you know, trying to impress all of the girls that was out there. And then again, you had the dudes who was out there that was, you know, smoking that dizza and doing their thing. And so it was like a happening. And then I happened to had also, it allowed me to always been artistic and, you know, to this day, you know, I'm an architect, but that was the beginnings, right? Because I was one of the graphic artists. And so I'd be tacking up all of the staircases and the projects and different things like that.
Nice.
So a lot of it was that it kept me out of trouble, so to speak, but it gave me something to do. But it was like, man, the anticipation of when you saw these dudes getting ready to set up the table. And, you know, you always had the hilarious stuff that somebody gets over exuberant. They're going to hit the table and the DJ box and everybody's going to go crazy. And, you know, or the power would just drop and then it would kick back on. But it was a happening, man. It was something that I'll never forget. I mean, I'm reliving it as I'm speaking to you about it.
Yeah, yeah. Facts, real talk. I'm going to come to you, Brother Darnley. Now, Darnley Hawes, of course, y'all know he's part of Blackamoor Films. He did this amazing documentary, American Cows.
American Lows.
Where the cows? Picking up the cows. Right.
Yeah. All good.
And just did a amazing joint for BET Digital. I didn't know this, or I forgot, but Brother Darnley, you were a hip-hop artist. You actually rapped. You sent me some links with you at KRS-One. So you were in it. How did hip-hop impact you? How did it help heal you and begin you on your journey?
I'm probably about 12 years behind y'all's generation. So for me, coming up in the 80s with hip hop, it was, I think the most distinctive thing is, of course, being a kid, you listen to what your parents listen to. So it was distinctly our music. It was distinctly something from our generation, our voice. And that's what immediately, of course, attracts everyone of that 70s, 80s generation to it, the fact that it was us speaking. You know, one of the things that Chuck D talks about is the fact that hip hop is one of the few art forms where it's a black man speaking to another black man. Now we can debate about what it is that we have to say to each other, but just that unique feature in of itself is what spoke to me. And of course, I can articulate it this way now as a 44-year-old man, but you know, back then I just, you know, you hear the beats and you know what I'm saying? You're just in it, you know what I'm saying? You hear the beats, you hear the rhymes, and you just want to be a part of it.
Absolutely.
But looking back, so it's one of these things where at the time you don't necessarily realize how it's affecting you. But now looking back, I realize how much I was inspired to read, for example, an autobiography of Malcolm X in like sixth grade. You know what I'm saying? And we rocking the X caps and the medallions, and I'm listening to X-Clan, I'm listening to, you know, Public Enemy, I'm listening to BDP, and how the consciousness was just part of the part of the culture and part of the just what was in the air. You know what I'm saying? So
absolutely.
Now what happens is when we see, it's one of the things that you kind of take for granted when it's part of it, but when it's missing, you miss it. Yeah. You know what I mean? Yeah. And it's one of the things where I think that if we had understood early on how integral that element would be in hip hop, I think a lot of us probably would have even fought even harder to keep it. You know what I'm saying? But that's another tangent.
Yeah, we're gonna hit that too. Yeah.
And that being said, you know, the early impression that hip hop has made on me still reverberates throughout the work that I do today. You know what I mean? It's still present in my desire to want to even be interested in the topics of our history, of our pre-colonial history, our pre-slavery history, and all that. Mm-hmm. You know, that is that seed that was planted through hip hop culture that has grown into making me want to study Medu Netra and travel to Kemet and studying mm-hmm. the Astro Kwesi and Tony Broder, and you know what I mean? That's where that seed was planted. So just in a nutshell, I'd say that's probably the biggest impact, that it's literally set my life on a trajectory that I'm still on right now today. And the work that I'm doing today is still an echo from, you know, still part of the ripple effect or domino effect from the messages I was getting in hip hop back in 86, 87.
No doubt. No, thank you for that, brother. I am jealous of Lord Jamar and Young Ghetto Dro, because y'all, do I need to light up myself? I'm just really jealous right now, goddammit. This is not right. I forgot it's a hip hop show. Rav Shock need to represent. You know, I got gummies. I'm sorry. I'm a punk. I got gummies. I like, you know,
gummies.
I got edibles. Okay. I'm sorry. Anyway.
whatever you do. You
know, hey, man.
Whatever it takes. New York City and New York State. For recreational use, so you can have up to 5 pounds in your house and not.
When did that pass?
A couple days ago.
Really?
Yeah.
I am moving to New York. Okay, so live from New York, the Philippe Massey Show. Let me go to Young Ghetto Dro. I think, I'm not sure, you might be the youngest on the panel, and you have amazing music. You've made an amazing contribution to the city of Sacramento, because you're here with me in Sactown. How did hip hop help heal you or help you as a youngin', as they say, coming up? Oh, unmute your mic.
Sorry about that. Well, coming up, you know, I come up in the era where, you know, there's a lot of drug dealing going on, pimping, especially in the Bay Area and stuff like that. So a lot of that was going on, we was involved with. And in doing that, you see the risk and you see stuff like that, and you try to find ways out and you ain't got nothing. I was able to use property, you know what I'm saying? No money to use this to start making some money. So I could start having ciphers and doing stuff like that. And then it kind of built up my network. And as they say, your network is based on your network. And through that, I was able to do other things with entrepreneurship and sell things and meet
people. I'm gonna mute your mic, Law, just for a moment. And then we'll have, when you come on, I'll have you on mute. Thank you, brother. Go ahead, Dro.
Yeah, so then I pretty much was saying, yeah, that was it, that it helped me network more, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
It helped me reach people in order to, you know, use my entrepreneurship to sell more things, my clothes, item merch, stuff like that. So that's what hip-hop really did for me. I created a platform for myself through hip-hop to do other things, you know what I'm saying? So
wonderful. Thank you for sharing. All right, brother Jazzy Bino, even though my baba is into jazz, but you know, you are a hip hop head for life, because that was our generation. That's where you come from. How did hip hop impact you, brother?
First and foremost, I'd like to thank you for the opportunity. And once again, Hotep to all the panelists. Love you guys. And good to get to know some of you even better as we go along. For me, growing up in the DMV, Prince George's County, Maryland, right outside of D.C., and coming up in the 70s and coming of age in the 80s. So I'm like just before Donnelly talking about 86, 87. I graduated high school in 87. So for us around, at, you know, in the DMV, one of our big mainstays and has always been since the early to mid 70s was Go-Go. So with that was kind of our hip hop thing. And we, you know, the New York thing would kind of leak down. And obviously Rapper's Delight, Curtis Blow, then, you know, eventually Run DMC and the other guys, they would, you know, that would come down because obviously we would get it, you know, from Howard University Radio and all of that. But one, I've been putting together a project of some music for my Baba, Professor Kaba Hiawatha Kamenek. And I've been in the 70s and the 80s. Mm-hmm. And so hip hop grabbed me really by when I went to college, because when I went to college, pretty much everybody else outside of the DMV was hip hop heads. Mm-hmm. And we were go-go heads. So it was like that mixture together. So they'd be like, "Ooh, I like that. Let me get that." And I'm like, "Okay, now I have never heard this before." And I'll say the song that got that took me to the next level. And as far as I'm like, I'm with this because I'm loving the James Brown, the Parliament, you know, Earth, Wind, and Fire, all of the samples being used. So I'm in it because I like this, and then it's the message. But for me, I'd say the song that it's just been running through my head that changed me in a very serious way was Public Enemies, Black Steel in the Moment of Chaos. That just, I mean, that right there, you know, I got a letter from the government the other day, opened and read it. They said it was suckers. I'm like, oh, that's it. That's my shit. Right. So, and then the next big one, you know, I went to a majority white school, like a lot of us. So I'm hanging out at a party one night and we're having a good time. And all of a sudden the song comes on and I'm like, "Oh, I like that." Next thing I hear, "Fuck the Police." And I'm like, I'm looking around. And ain't but so many of us up in this piece. When they come, I'm coming outside. They did it. Wasn't me. So that was the funniest shit ever. You know, I'm like, "Yo, what y'all got on, man? Don't y'all know the cops gonna come?" But just like everything else, would y'all just turn the music down? Mm-hmm. That was it. But if they had a thought that I was the one doing it or one of the other ones, but I went outside. I said, "I'm gonna end this real quick. I'm with these white folk." So, in the end of the day, I just think it's the, for me, our ancestor Prince's terminology. I'm a musicologist, so all of that Motown sound, 70s funk, disco craze, even classic rock, all of that gelled it and meld together to create hip hop, as far as I'm concerned. Now, as far as the music end of it, you know, because you're mixing all of these different things together. And at the end of the day, it's just the epitome of African music to me, because it's like my nickname, Jazzy Beano. Jazz is improvisation, and that's what we do as Africans. We improv off of everything. Mm-hmm. You know, you give us something, we're going to figure out how to fix it. We're going to figure out how to use it. Mm-hmm. And that's just who we are. So I would say that's probably for me the biggest impact.
Yeah. And just real quick, I just want to pick up on something my brother Jazzy Beano said. As a feather, I'm in Oxon Hill, bro. So I'm
in the harbor right now.
You know what I'm saying?
Nice.
No,
nice.
Just what he just said. He just ended the sentence right now. He said, you know, something like, you know, that's the way. What did you just say? You said, "We know how do we use it."
We improv. That's what
right. Yeah, he said improv. He said jazz is improv. This is how we do it. This is how we use it. Ba 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 da da da. Ba 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 da da. It's who we are. It's like the rhythm is
right.
In
rhythm,
other words, somebody else would have said that exact same sentence straight. I just wanted to highlight the rhythm that he used to explain.
We're born with bars.
It just comes out of us. Now is a perfect example right there. Just the way he even said it. was an example of what he was talking about.
Absolutely.
You know, we it's in us. It's just who we are.
It really is. I remember interviewing, I'm showing my age. I met Curtis Blow personally. I remember interviewing him. Beautiful brother. And it was the first time that I realized, you know, you always hear these stories about particularly those that begin and start, that are start of the movement of whatever, and how they got gypped and how they didn't make any money. And you know, it's kind of heartbreaking. And I think it was, Lord, I don't know if it was Lord Jamar or if it was Darnley, somebody said, I think it was Lord who said, you know, like after a point, it changes, and we have to keep our culture to ourselves, but somehow, some way, it got appropriated. And it wasn't, because it used to be underground street thing. It wasn't even on radio. It was just a part of the culture, and it was an underground thing. And then it became mainstream. I'll wait for Lord to come back and for Law to come back, and we'll complete that. But what's fascinating to me about hip hop, I can't remember a time that I did not have some hip hop music on 24/7, because for me, hip hop, there's certain artists I would listen to give me inspiration, and some I would listen to because I wanted to turn it up and I was pissed off, I was enraged, and the lyrics, like you were talking about, like Public Enemy and Straight Outta Compton, I needed that because that's how I was feeling, and hip hop was the soundtrack and the lyrics of my life. It was my expression that I, as Darnley said, black men talking to black men. It was the first time that I felt like somebody heard me, somebody felt me, somebody got me. Because, you know, granted, we all grew up listening to our parents' music and what have you. And God forbid, I had to suffer through some fucking Perry Como shit. And I don't know why to this day, Papa Loves Mambo still rings in my goddamn head, and I'm trying to get it out. I have put screwdrivers in my ears and everything, trying to get that Papa Love, that white shit. And so we understand that when hip hop came up, you know, Rapper's Delight, you know, the early years of hip hop. But even though we look at it as corny as hell now, when we heard that for the first time, or we heard the message for the first time, right? You know, don't push me to the edge. Oh, come on, you know. And how many of you had, well, I know like the young folks on here don't have, but how many of you had boomboxes? You had a boombox, bro? Come on, man. You got your mic muted.
I got a boombox right now.
What?
I got boom boxes and karaoke machines around here still. Here we go.
What? Okay. You remember the bigger the box, the badder you were. And remember, it was cassette tapes. And it was a whole underground thing.
Like Radio Raheem, that's all.
Ready? Oh, man. Now, what was that, 89? Or 1990, right? 1990. We're looking at Do the Right Thing. And when that opening scene, man, a Public Enemy, Fight the Power, I saw Do the Right Thing. Do the Right Thing was my generation's, my at that time, that was our Black Panther. I mean, I saw that movie at least 10, 15 times. In a row. I mean, I was just obsessed with the entire piece, but it was Public Enemy that was just, you know, Chuck D was just, well, he is a god, but the lyrics was just apropos to what I was experiencing. Lord Jamar, now I know Law keeps, I know he's hurt right now, he keeps dropping with his internet connection.
Philippe, could I add on for one moment?
Yeah, absolutely, brother. This is a global conversation.
because I think this is a good point, because I know where you're transitioning to the lyric piece.
Yeah.
But when we started, right, when we started out in the crowd,
music going. Is that a phone?
You know, that's, let me call, that's me.
Oh, okay. Mute your mic, brother. Or let me, yeah, there you go. Okay, go ahead.
Yeah, when we started, so this is, you know, I laugh because I really didn't realize that I was probably in the middle of the beginning of hip hop. And so, like I say, when we first started, it wasn't about the lyricist, because you really didn't have one.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you had a hype man. Like, if you like sex, then say, I like sex, you know. But
what's your sign?
Exactly. It was the beat. I mean, right. The
break beat.
Yes. When you heard that, doom, da, da, doom, da, doom, I mean, everybody would just jump. And then, because I used to DJ also, because again, everybody wanted to be part of this, right?
Yeah, and yeah, so yeah. Some facet. Yeah.
I'm out there with the little, on my porch with the little box with the two knobs mixing with a magnetic needles instead of the real cartridges, because you just wanted to do what you could do. I'm trying to mix with an 8-track.
I mean, wow.
So, shit. And pulling the little tape back and trying to make it just jump from,
wow.
from sound to sound, right? And so at one point, when it was the height of the night, all the DJ would do is just hit you with every break, and people would just be going crazy. And it was nothing but break beats. And I know the Lord can attest to that.
Right.
So I just wanted to lay that groundwork that that's really where it just started, with just bongos and drums. You know, there wasn't no such thing as strings or horns. That's the creative genius of how the thing evolved. And then again, having strong lyrics and lyricists was not even, like I say, something that you really heard. So go ahead, Lord. I didn't mean to cut
it. I was just going to say the beat. He's absolutely right. The beat was the star. Like, first of all, I was a little young dude with a big ass box. I'm walking around Radio Raheem, but I'm not big like Radio Raheem. Like, I was like 9, 10 years old or some shit like this. And I'm walking around with a big ass box, but I knew some people, so nobody took my shit from me, you know, but they could have, because
yeah, they'll stick you up.
Right. But they didn't. But part of the reason why is too, because I was so up on my hip hop shit. And when I walk around with this box, and I mean, I used to plan my shit out, like, you know, it's going to take me from this place to, you know, to play some shit. Right. So I might've played my hottest shit. Right. So now when I get to really where I want to be at, I got to rewind the tape. Right. And I have to put it to a point where what I really want to come on comes on by the time I'm like walking around the corner and you first see me. So I have to time this all out. So I'm now putting it to the song before that one. Okay, and then I know how I walk, my pace. Yeah, by the time I get to the corner, boom, fucking Super Sperm's gonna come on. Some shit like that. You know what I mean? And think about that when you're a young kid.
Yeah.
Like, just the title of a record, Super Sperm.
Right.
It's fucking risque. And like, and then the beat is mad hard. And it's just like, and for a DJ, that's a great song to cut up. Like, it was just all phenomenal. So yes, beats like that, the big beat, Daisy Lady, of course, Apache, which I originally thought was called Bongo Rock, because that's what people was calling it.
Yeah.
Oh, you ever heard this shit called Bongo Rock? Mm-hmm. And they describing it. And then the first time you hear it, you're like, yo, that shit is retarded. I never heard a break beat that was that long, where the drums went that long.
Mm-hmm.
Usually, you know, it's just a little bit, and you got to have that skill to keep it going. That's what hip hop. You know what I mean? That was part of the artistry of hip hop too. The bongo rock.
That Ralph McDonald.
You said Ralph McDonald.
that there was a break beat for Ralph McDonald that it, they would just go crazy.
Probably if I hear it. I don't, you know what I mean? Like, I was a DJ, but a lot of times I wasn't knowing necessarily all the names to shit. I just know the shit when I hear it. Like,
yeah. You know what I mean? Absolutely.
Because they used to have those super disco breaks. Remember super disco breaks?
Mm-hmm.
B-Man? Like, yeah. Yeah, Breakbeat Lou actually used to put those together and shit. So Catch Groove was the shit. Like, these were all like just. The beats was the shit, and then when you started, when people started rhyming to it, it's like, holy shit! Like, I didn't think this could get any better, but now right. Motherfuckers is like, and it was the routine. So now they're taking like popular songs or popular jingles from commercials and shit like that, and infusing it, you know, with these beats, but then using street language and. This is like just a wet dream of sound, like, you know what I mean, for a young black man coming up in this time, like, you know what I mean, and it was just beautiful. It was beautiful.
It really was. Facts. La, let me get you on, brother, because you keep dropping, so I want to get you on as quick as I can. I'm going to take you back to the original question. Unmute your mic for me. How did hip-hop heal you? How did it help you? How did you roll with it? Coming up, how did it help your life? Unmute your mic, Baba. There we go.
Peace. To add on to what my family was saying earlier, I also came up in the 80s and got influenced by the Black Power spirit of hip hop, right? Went to high school in LA, right? Seen Lord Jamar and Sadat X at the Palladium on the De La Soul Is Dead tour in 1991.
Wow.
And this was when y'all was doing Wake Up and Grand Poobah had not come on that leg of the tour with y'all. And you was, you know, up there doing your verse and Sadat verse. So I went out and I got the All For One cassette tape, right? Because I lived in a neighborhood that was gang related. You know, and a lot of us were joining the Zulu Nation in Los Angeles because that was, you know, if you were somebody who was seeing through the self-hatred of joining a side, you know what I'm saying? The Zulu Nation was our alternative, you know. But I remember when Wake Up came along on Rap City, right? And for somebody that was living in Los Angeles, you know, that became my anecdote, you know what I'm saying? So fast forward, graduated from high school in L.A., ended up going to Clark Atlanta. In Atlanta, and ran into the guard again after I had also become a member of the 5% Nation down in Atlanta under Waqil Allah and Wesley Muhammad, aka True Islam and these cats. Ran into Lord Jamar again at Soul Vegetarian in the West End, the Black Hebrew restaurant.
I remember that.
Soul Vegetarian.
Yeah.
Right. So the healing power of hip hop, right? Hip hop was my alternative to gang violence, right? I got my first Fisher Price turntable and record when I was 8 years old for Christmas from my mother and father. And my aunts and my uncles from uptown and Bronx, they embraced hip hop because of the nonviolent component about it early on, with the battling aspect of breaking, the battling aspect of DJing, the battling aspect of MCing. So, you know, I was a 74 baby, the youngest of five, you know what I'm saying? And the 83 and 84, that nonviolent component of hip hop, I remember seeing the elders around me push us towards the hip hop for those reasons. It was giving us an alternative to the gang violence and the things that was going on in the street. So, you know, had not, you know, Public Enemy made Nation of Millions, right? Had Step in the Arena and Daily Operation by, you know, Premier and Rest in Peace Guru, you know what I'm saying, not come along. The gods had not made Wake Up. You know, I wouldn't have gone to Clark, right? And had I not gone to Clark, I wouldn't have got the knowledge of myself, right? And if I had not got the knowledge of myself, I wouldn't have been a father, you know, when my children's mother abandoned them with me at 2 and 3 years old. So I became a single father at a young age and had to get serious. But hip hop was fuel. You know what I mean? Hip hop was my momentum. Ed OG and the Bulldogs making that song Be a Father to Your Child, you know what I mean, in 1990. It impacted the decision that I made to be a single father, though I probably really didn't know what I was doing and I was learning as I was going. You know what I mean? So Hip hop definitely has healing power.
Wow, brother. Thank you for sharing that history. That was amazing. So as Brother B-Man said, where I was going in terms of with the lyrics, you know, hip hop obviously has gone through massive changes, iterations, and metamorphoses. It started out, as you said, you know, with the beat. Then here comes the rap. You got, you know, your Sugar Hill Gang, which is kind of like a bubblegum hip hop, if you will. But when you're a kid, shit, and that's all there is on the radio, you rocking with that. Right. And then here comes, you know, Grandmaster Flash, you know, with the message. Oh, that's hard. This is the shit. You get this flavor. I'm in Chicago and you get the flavor of New York. You get the flavor like when New York and Chicago is kind of the same. You know, this is what the street life is. And then it goes from, you know, the battle rap thing and the message and all. Then it starts to move into a consciousness, right? It starts the Lord Jamar, when do you think conscious rap, because that's what Brand Nubian was about it. When did conscious rap start to make its introduction into the culture?
Well, I think if we really trace back, maybe it is the message. Maybe it is the message, because that's the first song where you hear people really talking about the ills of the ghetto and the ills of street life, but they're trying to tell you it in a way that's not trying to glorify it. They're trying to warn you about this shit.
Mm-hmm.
So then that led to songs like Run-DMC's biggest song, like It's Like That, and That's the Way It Is. Like, if you think about it, that's kind of a conscious song in a way. Like, they were trying to give a positive message with that. Like, from the knowledge that they were dealing with, these are not necessarily like Black Power type of individuals, but they were trying to give a positive message. I could give another example. The Fearless Four, they had a song called Problems of the World Today. Again, that's kind of conscious. You know, they're talking about the problems of the world today, but again, it's a cautionary tale, you know? And they're trying to, you know, make you think about the problem so that maybe you can find ways to solve the problem. So I think the songs like that helped lead us, you know, because man sharpens man, steel sharpens steel, the same way he's like, yo, you know, I did, you know, with this, and then I went to Clark, and then I wouldn't have had, you know, I have my whole shit with that. And then I'm sure there's other people that, you know, like KRS-One might have heard Problems of the World Today, and then made him think, you know, why don't I take it even deeper? Like, but he had a certain background, you see what I'm saying, as far as books that he read or whatever the case may be. So now he impacted that all into what he was doing. And then you start to see the emergence of what we today call conscious hip hop or whatever the case may be. But I think it started just out of rappers that you wouldn't have necessarily considered conscious. They just were trying to
tell the story as it is. It was almost like a journalist, right?
Well, no,
it's like street journalism. It's like, look, this is what's happening in the streets right now.
Well, yeah, they'll say this is what's going on in the streets, and beware. Don't get caught up in it. Don't you be a victim of it. Here's what's going on, but don't be a victim of it. It wasn't until later where it's like they tried to like paint all the terrible shit that's going on in the hood, all the trauma, and like report it in such a way that it was almost like they were glorifying it. But they're saying that they're reporting on it, but really they're glorifying it. You see what I'm saying? You saw when the tone shifted, like it shifted from we're telling you about this, but in a cautionary way, to we're telling you about this because we feel like this shit is live and we want to perpetuate this.
Around what time did that happen, do you think, when they started transitioning?
I mean, I think most people would agree. You know what? They want to put it on NWA, but now that I really think about it, one of the first people that I feel came with some gang negative shit was fucking Schoolie D.
That's it.
PSK.
PSK. PSK. Alongside killers.
Yeah.
Like, you had to be a street nigga to even know what PSK was.
Right.
Okay? So,
yeah.
But you know, NWA was the first one that like blew up nationally and right. had the whole like, and their production was just on a whole next level and their rhymes and everything. Like, they was the first ones to really like go, like, arena with it. You know what I mean? But I would blame it on Schoolie D.
Let me ask you this, Lamar. Can I add on something there?
Because there's actually a couple of interesting points in there that Lord Jamar brought up. And just to add on, I think we all remember back in the golden era of hip hop, it wasn't even that there was necessarily just conscious artists per se. Every single hip hop record had at least that one positive joint on it. That was almost like a requirement.
Just like you had one, you had to have one for the girls.
Exactly.
You know what I mean? One
you had to have
positive joint.
Exactly.
And whatever else you're about. Like,
exactly. And so just the fact that that was sort of an unspoken requirement within hip hop speaks to the consciousness of just in, again, just us as black men. And we're like, yo, you can't just do a whole record talking about gangsta. I mean, you know, that ain't, you don't wake up banging at breakfast. You know what I'm saying? You like my man said, you ain't mad at your grandma at breakfast, you know?
Mind you, these were kids 16, 17, 18, 19 years old.
Right.
A lot of them weren't even 20 years old.
Right.
Spoonie G told me he was 16 years old when he made Love Rap. I'm like, how the fuck are you giving advice like that at 16 years old? Well, I used to be around older dudes, you know what I mean? My uncle and them, they was older and they was some smooth motherfuckers and they used to put me up on game. You know what I mean? So he was able to speak beyond his years on the records. Because the shit he was saying, trust me, was way beyond his fucking years. Like, I thought he was way older than that. Like,
Facts.
I think another one of the key transition pieces was the rental advisory. You know, when they started bleeping stuff, initially when artists would come out, you know, they really couldn't talk about everything, you know. And then the next thing you know, it slowly got more harder and gangster, and they started relaxing it a little bit. And I think when that period kind of came in, I think it ushered in a stronger time for that gangster rap.
So that's a good point. When did hip hop get hijacked?
Not to cut you off, but real quick, I just wanted to add on real quick. Melly Mel recently spoke on the fact that before Run DMC, most rappers were trying to come with some sort of an image. Run DMC was the first rappers to promote a street image, like the image of a street thug type of nigga. They was the first ones to do that. And subsequently, that helped lead us down a road too. Not that I liked what we were doing prior to that, because you know, the shit we was wearing in hip hop looked like that fucking
terrible
funkadelic type of shit. And I wasn't with that shit neither. Them tight ass leather pants they was wearing. I wasn't with that shit. And so I as a street dude appreciated Run DMC. Of how they were dressing, like, yeah, they dressing like some regular street dudes. That's what I'm saying. And when they took all the music out and just sucker MCs just was the beat, I was like, this is a turning point right here.
Yeah.
Hip hop definitely made a turning point at that point. But for better and for worse. You know what I mean? Because that street persona never stopped.
Right.
That street, but we kept going deeper into that street persona, that drug dealing look. That's where the big gold chains come from. That was some street New York drug dealing style.
Let me ask you this, Lord, on the topic, on the subject. When did hip hop get hijacked by the powers that be, if you will? There was a point where, as we talk about it, hip hop was positive. Hip hop, even though we had, I don't even know if it was gangster rap at that time, but or there was a label for it, but something happened where the powers that be saw that hip hop could be weaponized, for lack of a better term, that they saw a connection between hip hop, the streets, and the prison industrial system. When do you think hip hop got hijacked and corrupted by the second frequency Amu, the European? When do you think that began to happen?
Well, you're talking about two different things. You're talking about the hijacking and you're talking about the weaponization. Those are two different things. The hijacking happened the minute that a black man said, yo, I could rap and da-da-da-da-da, and a white dude said, I got a record company, and they shook hands. That's the minute it happened. And, you know, that was even before, and it's quite a shame because Sugar Hill Gang, you know, Sylvia Robinson was a black woman.
Right.
But there were other record companies like Enjoy and Sleeping Bag and 4th and Broadway back then. And what else were other record companies?
Jive, Zomba.
Profile, yes. Tommy Boy, Jive, you know. These are all labels that, you know, white men that saw the shit early and was like, yo, let's do this shit. So from the minute that they had to like commercialize it in some kind of way, the fact that the Sugar Hill Gang and everybody that was on Sugar Hill Records were rhyming over like replayed breakbeats. And I'm like, why are they not just rhyming over the breakbeats that we hear in the fucking parties and shit? You know, it's because of business. They couldn't do it because the sample, they would have to pay the residual, you know, and all that type of shit. So right there, they're fucking up the art form. So it's getting hijacked as far as some of the authenticity was being taken away. But we sacrificed that because it was hardly any hip hop at all. So it was like, fuck it, we'll take it. You know what I mean?
Right.
And that's why the golden era is later, because we started doing hip hop the way that we thought it should be done. You know what I mean? When we were sampling, that's how we really heard the shit. And some of the best shit happened at that time. But now what you're talking about is when they realized that, you know, especially groups like Public Enemy and, you know what I mean? BDP, Brand Nubian, all of these type of Tribe Called Quest, they saw the type of influence that we had, not only on black people, but on white people as well. And it was very scary to them. They said, hold up. Like, we got to slow this shit down. So they tried to do things to try to slow those groups down, create rifts with inside the groups and all of that type of shit. Divide and conquer strategies. But somewhere along, as hip-hop was getting big, and I think NWA, who was very much patterned off of Public Enemy, except I'm at sonically, you know what I mean, production wise, all of that, but their message was just opposite, like, you know what I mean, it was just opposite. So I think they saw, yo, we can use that Public Enemy pattern, but we'll just talk this shit. And then when they saw how big it was, oh shit, yeah, that's the formula, that's it.
Fascinating.
But they actually, NWA also switched up, because they were more political on their first record. You know what I'm saying? I mean, Dre was like, you know, and express. He's like, I don't smoke weed or cess because that'll give a brother brain damage, and brain damage on the mic don't manage, right? And then he comes out with the chronic too. You know what I'm saying? He makes his whole image around. So, you know, they you know, cast their little flip flop once they realize.
To me, that's what I'm saying. That was like the obligatory positive joint to them. Like they almost felt like they had to do something positive. But I think another thing that the negative shit, how it pulls people in, is it uses the material world, whereas the conscious world doesn't really do that. You see, the conscious world will play that they won't, you know, conscious rappers weren't really wearing big gold chains and shit like that. They were trying to get away from that type of shit. We were trying to put that shit down, and we're wearing the wooden beads and shit like that. You know what I mean? And trying to be, you know, the material world. Meanwhile, they're using all that to lure the average person in, you know. So I remember seeing BZE with Lamborghinis and fucking Ferraris and shit like that, and that shit is alluring to people, you know? And so now, who are you gonna listen to, the guy with big gold chains on or the guy with big wooden fucking chains on? You know what I mean?
But Muhammad Ali was doing that back in the day. I mean, so you can be conscious and still get people attention with buying flashy things. You know what I'm saying?
Right, but at that time, we thought we was trying to be the opposite of that. You see? Mm-hmm. So we was putting it down.
Mm-hmm.
Like, like, if you look at my first single cover, like, we still wearing a little bit of jewelry and shit like that. Like, I got a chain on, I got some rings and bracelet on and shit like that. And you know what I mean? But by the next fucking shit, we had took all of that shit off, thinking like, nah, that shit is negative. Like, you know what I mean? Like, that's not the message we want to portray to our people. You see? But maybe we should have fucking used some of that, you see, because you got to mix in our the sugar. You know, you got to mix sugar into the medicine.
Like,
fuckers eat it. So that's why I do kind of do shit like that now. You know what I mean? Like, I do got my chains and shit, but they're going to be like Pharaoh instead of Jesus head. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's going to be an unk instead of a cross. You see what I'm saying? Like, that's how you do it on them.
Lon, let me get you coming in since you're coming back on. Weaponizing and hijacking of hip-hop. Your thoughts on it?
Just to add on to what they were saying, I think it's when it became a commodity. I think when, you know, the culture was turned into a commodity and they saw it as something that they can market and sell, that's what they did with it. You know, then there is, you know, this idea about hyper-exploitation, right? Because when we look at the music industry, all genres were exploited by the corporate structure. You know what I mean? But you know, just conceptually, the same way they took heroin and flooded the community and it led to crack and blah, 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 blah. You know what I mean? The hyper exploitation of the image through hip hop and the sound of hip hop. It was like taking heroin through the ears and heroin through the eyes. Right. Because they demoralized, you know, whatever moral compass that we had within the culture. Like brother was saying, Dre saying, I don't smoke weed assess. You know, that's our moral compass. I need lyrics. Right. So, you know, they then comes the Chronic. Right. And why was the Chronic considered to be such a success? It was about how many records it sold. So you also see the transition when the primary concern about how much money you were getting became more important than, you know, your lyrical skill or the quality of your music, you know, and you had to automatically have the $1 million producer, you know, rather than your DJ or the cat that you came up with. And it just came less about the culture and more about the commodity and the cash and the profit and everything that came along with it. You know, when it became more capitalistic, you know, like Common said, you know, she was realer when she doing it in the park, right? So, you know, when capitalism got involved, man, it corrupted hip hop like it corrupts everything, you know?
Wow. Good stuff. Good stuff. Jazzy Beano, your thoughts when hip hop was weaponized and hijacked?
As listening to the brothers talk and pontificate on their understanding of everything, the only thing I could keeps coming in my head is KRS-One, BDP, Love Is Gonna Get You. And just that when that came out, that whole album, that live album, to me it was one of those just seminal moments. But just him saying love was gonna get you, and it seemed like right after that, it had to be very, very close. But then, like Lord Jamal was saying, you had the all of a sudden this capitalization on it, and they had to demonize it. They had to switch it, because at the end of the day, they had seen it before and it was called rock and roll. They had seen it before and it was called Motown. They had seen it before and it was called disco. And they knew, we got to flip this. And like Lord Jamar and the rest of the panel were saying, you know, that materialistic thing came in there. So like I said, in my mind, I just hear KRS-One, Love Is Gonna Get You. And to me, that was like my break point where I saw just this other thing. And I'm like, what are they talking about? I'm like, one or two songs on an album, I'm cool with that, because it's talking about what's going on in your neighborhood. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I mean, because I go back to the original, what I think are the original rappers. I think about Bobby Womack, you know? Yeah, yeah. I love you when you're down and out. You know what I mean? Across 110th Street, mm-hmm. telling you what's going on at that moment. And that's what I think the brothers were doing. You know, we had our fun dance, we had our little things, but at the end of the day, we still was trying to kick some verbs to people and say, hey, these are action things, look out for this. And to me, it just, like, I mean, we would say NWA to a degree, and how they kind of commercial, but just, I mean, we could even go to Luke to a degree.
Sexualization.
That's the other side of the street.
Right.
Yeah. That's the other side of the street, but it's still that, you know, that where can we pinpoint everybody saying this is how these black people are and this is what they're talking about? Mm-hmm. So stay away from it. Or I'm gonna suck you in and you run with it. So now all I want to do is have the bling, 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 you know, the girl with the big ass. I got a car, I'm slinging dope, you know. This is what's selling. This is what's happening. This is what's in. So, like I said, I just go back to KRS-One. Love's gonna get you.
Dro, let me talk to you about it. Well, you're old enough to kind of be able to delineate this. When do you think hip hop became weaponized and hijacked?
Well, to me, from my knowledge, I was born in '87. You know what I'm saying? So my knowledge, what we always say, that you see the time, the hip hop era you guys are talking about, to me is more like BC, like you know what I'm saying? And the hip hop era I came up in, AD, it's not even a question. You know what I'm saying? So the hip hop time y'all talking about, I don't
know. Can you mute your mic, Law? Because I think we're getting some feedback, bro.
Yeah. I don't really know about the hip hop time you guys are talking about. You know what I'm saying? So for me, I would say that art is a reflection of life. And due to the crack epidemic, that made it more, you know, like people wanted to, that was their lifestyle. So mm-hmm. this is why it became more popular. You know what I'm saying? So in my mind, that's how it works. It's not like somebody came and said, hey, we're going to make y'all start rapping like this. No, actually, life was getting harder in the ghetto. Actually, there was more gang violence. Actually, there was more people dying. There was more drugs. So then you're going to hear this more in the music. You're going to see this more in the art, because art is a reflection of life. So in my mind, it happened, you know what I'm saying, after crack. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So, and then, you know, it was up in the air. I don't really just say, you know, somebody came and, I don't really like how that sounds, like someone could just come and take it and manipulate us and do this. I just feel like that, yeah, it was happening. And then, yeah, people made a business out of it eventually, you know, but I don't think people were rapping like that, obviously, for someone to find them, right? So, like, people had to be rapping about the streets and all of this stuff. And then they say, hey, you guys are rapping about it, we can make money off of you. So it was happening. It wasn't like somebody came and just created this group and said, hey, we want y'all to rap about this because, you know, we want you to destroy the black community and yada, yada, yada. Nah, Ice Cube is a real dude. Dr. Dre, those are real guys. They're not agents, even though they do agent things. I mean, not Ice Cube, but, you know, some of the rappers do agent things. They're not really agents. Those are real dudes that really were rapping. You know what I'm saying? So, and when, you know, so in my mind, you know, that's how it works. And in my mind, you know, the conscious rapper to me is Tupac. You know what I'm saying? So that's a conscious rapper to me, you know. So, and he not conscious. It's like, so we didn't really have too many conscious rappers that I felt like were just extremely popular. So, you know, you know, more now, nowadays, I know more conscious rappers, Lupe Fiasco, Talib Kweli, and stuff like that. But yeah, coming up in the early 2000s and late 90s, that's all I knew was gangster rap.
Wow. Thank you for that, Brother Dro. Now, Darnley, your thoughts on it?
I think there's a couple things going on, because one of the things that Dro just said that's very poignant is the fact that, like you said, coming up in the 90s, early 2000s, that's kind of mostly what was available. So then the question becomes, well, why is that what was available? Yes, artists do make what they make, and you know, the labels kind of pick from what these artists make. At the same time, there has absolutely been an effort to ignore entire categories of hip hop within the industry. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And people use the excuse, oh, it doesn't sell, but you know, Fuji sold 24 million worldwide. You know, Tribe Called Quest sold 20 something million worldwide. You know, so it's not like these types of groups didn't sell. And so there absolutely has been a concerted effort, a deliberate effort within the industry to keep certain types of images of Black people within hip hop relevant while making other images irrelevant. You know what I mean? Because mm-hmm. like you said, it's not like cats weren't making conscious hip hop in the 2000s and 90s when you came up, mm-hmm. but you didn't hear it because it wasn't made available to you to hear as abundantly as some of the other styles. You know what I'm saying? So, mm-hmm. so I guess I just wanted to make that clear that it's not more so that brothers are trying to imply that somebody's saying, okay, I'm going to create this group and you know what I'm saying? And create this weapon. It's more so they look at the field of play and see what it is that we're already doing. And then they find the ways to use it against us. You know, they do it all the time just with, look how many people, brothers started sagging their jeans, what they start doing, hand out tickets for sagging your jeans, right? You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. A certain area. You know, they look at whatever it is that we do and they figure out how they can, because anytime you go into somebody else to finance it, somebody else to promote it, that becomes a gatekeeper right there. That's the reason independent music is such a danger, because you eliminate that gatekeeper, you eliminate that filter, you know? So I just want to say that for one. But secondly, like I think Brother La said, Vino said earlier, like you said, before this, they did the same thing with hip hop. I mean, with hip hop, as he did with soul, as he did with jazz, as he did with every, bottom line is every music form in America is a Black music form, including mm-hmm. country, including bluegrass. You know what I'm saying? The banjo comes from West Africa. Sure. Banjo is a West African word. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So it all comes from us. So all they're doing in hip hop is just following the pattern they've done for the hundreds of years that we've been here, and that we've been the creative source of we've been the source of American creativity, period. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? What is creative America without Black people?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? They were playing basketball for how long until we got in the game. And look what we did with it. You know what I'm saying? They had the piano, the saxophone, the trumpet. They had all these instruments for how long until we got a hold of it? You know what I'm saying? And did something completely different. So, you know, I think that it's also too important for us to learn the lesson and understand that whatever we come up with next as a people, it's going to try to happen again. So we got to be on the lookout. We got to be ready. You know, we got to teach the youth, like, listen, y'all going to use your creativity. You're going to, you know, hip hop been around 40 something years now. It's time for the youth to come up with something else. You know what I'm saying? It's time for them to come, you know, do your thing, but know that when you do come up with it and they start copying it, they get, this whole cycle is going to try to start again. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And
right.
Every generation, I mean, it happened with the blaxploitation, the so-called blaxploitation films. When you look at what Melvin Band people was trying to do versus what eventually became like with Dolemite and Superfly and that kind of stuff became.
Yep.
So we always start off with like this thread of consciousness in what we do and spirituality too. You know what I'm saying? Y'all know in hip hop, everybody was a 5% of Nation of Islam. You know what I'm saying? Right. It's like, you know, shoot, I first learned Yo Assalamu Alaikum, Wa Alaikum Assalam, my universal greeting for the people of Akan from PRT. You know what I'm saying?
Right, right.
You know, I mean, that was just in the music and the culture. So it's going to come back again too. Whatever we do next, right. And they're going to try to get it, they're going to try to push it out as well. So I think it's basically just a cautionary tale for us as Black people to understand how these cycles happen and for us to be able to limit it or stop it the next time around and actually be the ones who actually benefit because there's nothing wrong with capitalizing as long as we're the ones capitalizing on our own capital,
right?
On our own creativity. Right. You know what I'm saying? You know, it's like, shoot, it's no different than working on the plantations. It's like, you know, if brothers were owning the farms, we was owning plantations, hey, cool. You know, the problem was we was working out there for free and get right. ass in the process. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, that's how these record labels have been run. And a lot of, that's how a lot of this industry has treated us as well. You know what I'm saying? And so I'm glad to see a lot of more brothers are taking control of the business. Last thing I'll just say, too, it's also important to, that we preserve hip hop as music. And not just as music and culture, not just as a business. Because I, one thing that I kind of get discouraged about is every time you bring up hip hop as music, the conversation always goes into a conversation about business. Mm. But that never happens when I'm talking about jazz. Never happens when I'm talking. Nobody says, "Yo, how many did Mozart sell? Business. Yo, how many records did John Coltrane sell? Yo, what label was Anita Baker on?" Nobody cares. But when you talk about hip hop, all this business stuff starts getting into it. And to me, that says that we still have a ways to go in terms of really examining and dealing with hip hop as music, as art, on its own terms, as art, period. Forget the business.
Wow.
You know,
beautiful.
Like, forget all these, you forget all that. We just need to just deal with the music and preserve the music.
I appreciate that. I know Lord Jamar is getting that grub on, but I'm going to come to you for a minute, brother. somebody put in the chat, you remember when, Fuck the Police came out? And it went federal, and then there was another lawsuit or something, I think, with NW. It was either with Luke, I believe. So what are your thoughts on that? And how did that change the game, or did that make it even more legitimate for us to lean into it? Lord, your thoughts on that.
Well, if I'm not mistaken, those were the type of records that ushered in the stickers that we were talking about earlier.
Mm-hmm.
That,
mm-hmm.
Parental advisory stickers. And once you put those parental advisory stickers on, that was supposed to say, well, I can say whatever I want now. Like, you can't really censor me. That was a way to try to stop censorship, I guess. Or so people thought, but I guess it opened Pandora's box to people really just saying whatever the fuck they wanted to say.
Like,
and as long as that sticker was on there, you know, you were protected.
What?
And as long as you didn't say certain things, because just even with that sticker, it still was certain.
You didn't say certain things.
If you crossed the line, don't get in trouble.
Right, right.
Talk about them Jews.
Right, right.
Oh, you can kill a nigga all day on record. You can pimp black women up and down the avenue. You can, you know, you can eat babies if you want to. But don't you start talking about them Jews.
You trying to get my show canceled. Hey. That's what you're trying to do right there, Lord. You're trying to get shot to his prime. This is on my last damn show.
I'm just saying, they made an example of
you made Kenny.
That's a grift. You made a little analogy, something about jewelry or something like that. And he's paying for it to this day.
Wow, yeah. Real talk.
Day.
Do you remember when at one point, if you didn't, if an R&B or pop artist didn't have a rapper or a rap lyric on their record, they couldn't even really get a deal and it didn't sell. When did that happen where hip-hop became so powerful that it influenced, or should I say it infiltrated, all genres of music?
I'd say mid-80s. I mean, mid-90s.
Mid-90s?
Yeah,
I'd say mid-90s.
I agree.
Yeah, because, I mean, you would look at, I mean, I'm just sitting here thinking of, like you said, like J-Lo and,
yeah.
I mean, everybody, they had
their, Gwen Stefani and Eve.
Exactly. Yeah. You know, they had their top 40 thing, But then when they had the remix had to have somebody on their rap with a little rap in there. So I would say like mid-90s to early 2000s when that really took hold. And so at the end of the day, that could probably even, we could probably single out that time frame as when the hijacking really took over. Because now you're putting it in this mainstream thing. So, okay, it's hot enough for us to have it for this, but we're still going to put something else on the other side of the street. We're going to take advantage of this because, I mean, at the end of the day, that's what it's all about. The ends against the middle.
Okay.
For me, I'd say that. I'd say like mid-90s.
Okay.
I think also when they had the New Jack Swing, Bobby Brown, Father MC, when they started kicking that.
You're talking about Puffy, really, is what you're talking
about. I was just getting ready to go there. Like the impact of Puff was a fucking beast. I mean, we never saw nothing like that.
I mean, he took that New York, you know, uptown mixtape culture and made it national, you know. He took what DJs were already doing on the street and just put it on wax. And you know, Mary J was a beneficiary of that. A lot of his singing groups were beneficiary of that, which led to more singers and stuff wanting to do a hip-hop combo type of thing. And you know what I mean?
But man,
now the line is so blurred. Is this rapper a singer? Is this singer a rapper? Like,
yeah.
Where is it?
Let's stay on that though, because we're talking about the impact
of rhyme, or is this a song? I'm not sure.
Let's stay on that because I want to talk about, as we're talking about the impact of hip hop, let's talk about the impact of certain individuals in hip hop. Snoop Dogg, Ice Cube, Biggie, Tupac. How, when you hear those names, you feel some kind of way. You snap back to a mirage of memories and where you were and what you were doing. Being that you're in New York, Brother Lord, how was it when Puff dropped Biggie, and Biggie was introduced into the culture? How did that land in at the time when you were doing what you were doing?
I mean, you know, it's funny because we were talking about how business gets brought into it, you know?
Yeah.
I think New York had been, to use better words, losing when it came to like sales and shit like that.
Really?
Now, why we should even fucking care about that?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, really? Because at the end of the day, it's like, who's the better fucking slave? Who's making more money for Massa? But, you know, the West Coast was killing it with sales and shit like that. So now Biggie came out and I saw what he was doing. He was mixing that New York shit with that Cali shit, and it resulted in sales. So people start to see a formula too. They start to see, well, if I follow a certain formula, not only did Biggie have some Cali, you know, sounding shit, you know, his themes were shit that Cali motherfuckers would relate to. The gangster shit he was talking about, and just all just the street shit he was talking about. Like, he knew it would resonate with people in all hoods, really. You know what I mean? He just had to give it a sound that was more appealing to those markets. And I think Puffy knew that already. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
He had that kind of insight already being in the music industry. So they were just masterful on the type of tracks, the type of, you know, kind of backdrop they put them on, you know.
Anybody else the impact of Tupac, Biggie, Dre, Snoop, what are your thoughts? How does it land?
I would say when you talk about Tupac, I think Tupac's an interesting figure in hip hop just because I'll set it up this way, right? It would be ridiculous if somebody said, yo, I love reggae, but I don't really mess with Bob Marley. Right? That would be a completely ridiculous statement, right? Or right. Go, yo, I love soul music, but I'm not really a fan of James Brown. Right? Mm-hmm. You'd be like, how's that possible? Hip hop doesn't really have a single artist that kind of fits that, because you can like different artists in hip hop and still be hip hop. Mm-hmm. But if there was one, I say Tupac's the closest thing to that. Tupac seems to be the one cat that, regardless of what generation of hip hop you're from, we kind of agree on. Mm. You know what I'm saying? Whether you're a 50-year-old hip hop head or a 20-year-old hip hop head, we all kind of agree on Tupac. And I think it's because, you know, he was from the East Coast, went to the West Coast. He brought those different influences, and he spoke the full sort of 360 degree kind of range of who he was, and that resonates. You know what I'm saying? So, I think that he
helped and hurt hip hop.
Can we agree?
I can agree. Sure. Yeah. Sure.
He had all of those things. He encompassed all of that. He was very inspirational to certain people. Like, yo, he got positive shit about him. And he was mad fucking negative. He inspired mad negative shit.
Right.
Motherfuckers died when he died over the shit that he inspired in people. People got killed because of Tupac.
Yeah.
And
we can't agree too. Tupac did change too, as he, you know what I'm saying? He kind of evolved as his personality evolved
he had more knowledge in the beginning.
Yeah,
and
right.
Got more into some things to shit later in his life.
Yeah, that's true.
It was almost like he was the character in Juice, right? I mean, no delay.
Not looking at Dro. All of y'all have all these expressions. I gotta get it all in.
Because Tupac is one of those sacred cows that people don't like to talk about.
So. Yeah.
And we don't, you know, we like to talk romantically about our heroes and not look at them as human beings and for the full scope of what they are.
Sure, looking at their flaws.
That's why he could arguably be that one artist that everybody kind of agrees on.
Right.
You see what I'm saying? But there's a lot of shit to agree on him about.
Right.
Brilliant. Yes, he was, you know, he could make people feel a lot of shit.
Right.
Positive and negative. You know what I mean?
Right.
And he made people act positive and negative. You know what I mean?
B-Man, your thoughts?
It's real.
Well, I'm struggling with this one because I'm not a Tupac guy, but I'm New York all day, right? And so one of the things about New York is Tupac doesn't resonate with a lot of us. Mm. And I can't put my finger on it. The Lord probably could speak a little bit to it.
Well, I feel like he does in the conscious community, because that conscious side of him, he caught us with that earlier on. You see what I'm saying?
Just got a baby and yeah.
Even before that, like Strictly For My Niggas album. He was just more conscious, and he was fucking with New York dudes at that time. Don't forget, he used to run with Stretch from Queens and all of that, Live Squad and all of these type of dudes. Like, he used to be running with Tretch and shit like that from Naughty by Nature and shit like that.
Mm-hmm.
He used to have mad love for the East Coast, like, and a lot of his earlier music was kind of some East Coast shit. It's almost like him and Biggie did the opposite.
It's interesting. Yeah.
Yeah, they kind of like switched. And I remember being at the Palladium at a Tupac show when he brought fucking Biggie Smalls out.
Yep.
And nobody hardly even knew who the fuck Biggie was. And Tupac was big. And I was just like, wow. I was like, he didn't have to do that. I was that's some ill shit. I said, but that's ill for him to recognize that this guy is going to be big, because I already knew that Big was going to be big too. And I was like, yo, this dude Pac recognizes, that's ill. That was crazy.
Yeah, brother Dro, your thoughts. You had something to say on this.
Nah, I was just listening to how people look at Tupac, you know what I'm saying? Especially y'all from, because to me, I try not to mix the conscious side of him up with the entertainment side of him. You know what I'm saying? Mm. Because I know that he was conscious to know that he had to show up and do a job as an entertainer. You know what I'm saying? So it was a lot of things that I feel like was very calculated with Tupac when he did it. You know what I'm saying? So sometimes he did it for shock value. You know what I'm saying? In my mind. You know what I'm saying? But then other people look at it like, oh, he was just dumb and he was ignorant. He was out here looking stupid. And to me, it's like, yeah, he was doing what you said, giving them their medicine and a piece of candy down there. You know what I'm saying? Because I got a lot of jewels from him. You know what I'm saying? If it wasn't for him, I probably wouldn't be sitting here on this panel with y'all. You know what I'm saying? Him, people like Nas, you know what I'm saying? That, you know, still was street, but then they would kind of, you know, drop it in. Because for me, that's kind of was reality to me. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, so that's how I kind of look at it with the Tupac thing.
Right. But at the same time, right, his motivations, I mean, they matter, but it doesn't necessarily matter in what we're talking about here. We're talking about what kind of impact did he have? See what I'm saying? So you're talking about why he may have done this thing. We're saying the impact of what he did. So yes, he was conscious and he inspired people like you to be conscious. But at the same time, whether he was being an entertainer or not, he projected a certain negativity that was real in the world to other people and resulted in real world shit. Like some niggas wanted to be like Tupac and they ended up getting killed. You understand?
Yeah.
Like, well, that's real shit.
No, it was like mad dichotomous.
And went out there and said, thug life, nigga, and got their ass smoked. Mm. Because they were inspired by him doing his job or whatever the fuck. Mm. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, you see what I'm saying? That's real life impact. Regardless if he was just being an entertainer, that's crossing the line of an entertainer when you're impacting people. Well, entertainers do impact people's lives, but some more than others. Mm-hmm. And I'm saying that Tupac had such an emotional connection to people that he was able to move people in different ways, positive and negative. Mm-hmm. The reason that you're able to be here could be because of Tupac, but then there's some people that are not here because of Tupac.
Mm,
and we have to address that too.
Yes, we do. Yes. Thank you for bringing that up. Thank you for bringing that up and out, brother. That's why we you're a historian on the panel. Now, Law, what do you think about it? Your thoughts on where we're at with Tupac.
Something that's spinning through my head is also around.
Oh, shit.
Oh, man.
God damn it, I want to hear that. Yeah. All right, he'll be back. Who wants to say something?
I was going to say one thing. Okay.
No, go ahead, brother.
No, I was going to say, like, how much responsibility is it of Tupac's that what other people do after listening to his music? Like, when do we, like, draw the line between entertainment and social leadership?
I hate that question. You know why? Because
that's question.
Pop out questions. First of all, life imitates art and art imitates life. Let's not sit here and act like, you know, when we was young, we didn't go to the fucking karate movie, watch the karate movie, come outside and start chopping the shit out of your fucking best friend. Okay? But don't act like fucking music. People can't listen to this music and get so hyped up and be like, yo, fuck that. I'm gonna go out here and shoot.
I'm gonna turn some shit up. Yeah.
Like, and we know that. We know I made music purposely to try to push people down the road to get knowledge of self.
One them
you see what I'm saying? And yes, I made songs like Pass the Gat too, because I want you to protect yourself against unlawful fucking shit. You know what I mean? If you need to protect yourself. The artist has to take a certain responsibility for their art. They have to know that if they are as good as they say they are, that their art is going to move people. And so we can't be like, oh, well, you got to raise your kids and all this fucking shit. We're all responsible for each other. And it's a cop-out when we act like the artist has no responsibility. He's just reporting what he sees and all this fucking shit. I've heard that fucking shit for years and years. Mm-hmm. And it's a weak fucking argument. I don't like it. I don't like it. We have to fucking take responsibility for what the fuck we say. IG now. I can't even say that a vaccine is bad now on IG.
Yeah.
Because they're making me take responsibility for what I say and all this fucking shit. And they're telling me that that's medical misinformation and all kind of fucking shit. So they want me to fucking, you know, be responsible with what I say. And how responsible does an artist? Yeah, an artist is responsible for what the fuck he says. And
so I want to cut the line, but you just brought up a really powerful point, Lord. So let's stay on that for a minute. Well, hold on. I want to come back to that because I want to make that a segment. Darling, do you mind holding? Let's finish this piece.
I just want to just point out something that I noticed. Brother Dro was talking about being an entertainer, and then Lord Jamar started talking about being an artist. And a lot of times we use those terms interchangeably, and they're really not. You know, in my mind, the entertainer is somebody who is taking what they can from the art form for the purpose of others, to service others, to entertain others. The artist is contributing to the art form. The artist is adding something to the art form. You follow me? To me, the entertainer takes the best parts and uses the most, you know, sellable stuff. Oh, I'll take this. Okay, you know, we don't want the DJ. We'll move the DJ aside. We're just going to take the rapper. And, you know, we don't want the B-boy. You know what I'm saying? They pick and choose what they want from hip-hop. The artist is contributing to it. So
they're both affecting people.
Exactly. Exactly. And so I think that an artist will take responsibility for their art. But somebody who's just trying to entertain, they're already going into it just for entertainment, just to take what they can and get what they can, not to actually contribute anything.
Good stuff.
You see what I'm saying? So I think that the mistake in the first place is just being an entertainer, period. You know what I'm saying? If you need to be an artist. If you're an artist, you're going to take responsibility for your art. If you're just there to entertain, then I think you're in it from the wrong reason to begin with.
Hold on, because somebody... Imperial G just dropped a bomb, and it was really a good piece.
Yes, Al Pacino is responsible for some of these fucking coke dealers. Imperial G. Fucking is. And the director and the motherfucking whatever fucking Paramount or whoever the fucking put that shit out, everybody in that fucking thing is responsible.
Exactly. Why don't we talk about Wesley Snipes like we talk about Tupac?
I was about to bring it up next. You know how many cats I knew who was trying to be
right now? In the conscious community a lot of the times. You know what I'm saying? I mean, there's a lot of other things, forms of art that contribute a lot of negativity to the conscious community that we all deal with.
Let's call them all out. But we happen to be talking about rap right now. If we want to talk about movies and shit like that, we can cross over to that. We can talk about literature. There's a whole lot of shit we can talk about.
We talk about visual art. You know what I'm saying? So you could just see, you feel me, the difference. Where you're like, well, you know what?
I absolutely agree with you, and I think they should all be called out. I'm not saying we should.
So you think we should get rid of gangsta rap music, that music that you consider that completely?
No, I didn't say that.
It's about context.
I haven't said that. Context. I love gangsta rap.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Yeah.
I love gangsta rap. But then that's the fucking, that's the oxymoron. That's the fucking, whatever you want to call it. Yeah, I guess that's it. An oxymoron. Like a part of me loves gangster shit because a part of me used to do some gangster shit. You know what I'm saying? But then there's that conscious side of me too. So we all have certain parts of us that come into conflict with each other. And to be real about it, you know what I mean? I'm just being real about the many facets. We're not one dimensional. You're not just on some gangster shit. Mm-hmm. I went into the middle of the Jordan Downs and thought that these gangster niggas was just all about gang shit and had a political discussion for fucking hours with dudes with hairy curls and shit.
Peace.
That I thought had no understanding of anything just because they had a Jerry curl. And they totally blew me away with the type of knowledge that they had.
Wow.
So,
But see, so, that's what, I mean, that's what they've done. That's what they've done to the culture, right? I mean, the culture should be a balanced buffet. You should be able to pull whatever kind of music that you want. If you want Rob Bass, you get you some Rob Bass. Hmm. If you want some Special Ed, you get you some Special Ed. If you want EPMD,
Biz Mark,
you know, you get, yeah, you get the Biz, you get EPMD, you know. But what the powers that be is a couple things, and I love the conversation because it's always baffled me, because when you're in the record pool, and Lord Jamal knows this, they send you all kind of music. And there's a lot of music that was fantastic that never got off the ground.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You would be bumping today, but you never even get a chance to see it. And so part of it is that just like they're always looking to monetize our culture. You know, they got worried when we started wearing our hats backwards, then white boys started wearing their hats.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Where's that coming from? And then we build the anthem, like Uptown Baby, Deja Vu. And the next thing you know, Steely Dan says, well, hey, you can't do that. That's my music. And now you stop a movement. And so they have realized that if they can control this, they can control us. And that's the biggest thing that hopefully we can kind of figure out from this panel is what does it look like in the future? And how do we keep these folks from corrupting our culture and allowing us to control the cultural credit, you know?
Now, before we answer that question, I want to get Law's opinion on where we're at right now. Because, you know, Law, you did a master's degree. And it was a very dope process that you put together in terms of sociology and music and all that. Talk to me about this and how it relates to the conversation that the segment of this conversation that you're hearing now, bro.
Word. So probably around 2012, you know, we said that underdog music but out of business. And we were just strictly in art to just kind of tack on to what everyone's talking about, you know, because when you're trying to make your art a business, then you're, like everyone has said previously, you know, then the business components become, you know, what become important, and the art gets compromised in the process, mm-hmm. right? So, you know, in that context, when I went back to school after some time, we had started you know, kind of what got me into the master's program was that we had started a Sacramento Zulu Nation chapter that had become active in working with at-risk youth organizations in Oak Park and Meadowview and other areas around town. So mm-hmm. UC Davis and Sac State started asking us to come talk to their grad and master's classes about community engagement and how to sustain engagement with community organizations. So, within the process of doing the master's degree, you know, and studying human rights was my focus. How, you know, what is the next logical step for people in the world dealing with racial, class, and gender inequality? You know what I'm saying? And what came out from the research was that human rights is the next logical step. And in the process of studying human rights, I realized that human rights was pretty much an idea within colonialism, right? Mm-hmm. So when we're talking about colonized people or melanated people or original people or those of us that are part of the Pan-African diaspora, right? You know, not only do we have to think about the restoration of our humanity, but we also have to wrestle with the notion of decolonizing ourselves within that. We almost have to first decolonize ourselves in order to exercise our full human rights. Uh-huh. So in recognition of that, I was like, well, you know, hell, the first thing I got to do is keep it true to myself and practice my culture, because that's the best way I can exercise human rights. So with my man here in town, Rod Nice, shout out to the BAP Notes. I'd go to his crib with my research at the end of the night, right? And Rod would be in there making beats on an MPC, and little by little, organically, You know, we would just compose the project Underdog's Manifesto out of a combination of instrumentals that Rod would just be simultaneously making while we'd be sitting in the garage with the beat machine, and the homies would be sitting around drinking and smoking, interested in this research I was bringing from the university. They wanted me to read some of that stuff to them. And that was literally how we came to make a hip hop project out of the master's thesis. You know what I'm saying? Wow. It was inspired by the reaction that we got from homies on the block. You know what I'm saying? Who wasn't in the program. And a lot of them wanted to hear that stuff that they was feeding us in the master's program because they couldn't believe that I had made it into the master's program. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So a lot of that was about like, all right, hood homie, you in this master's program, show us what this all about. You know what I mean? Right. Rod would be sitting there banging out the beats and I'd be reading and narrating this stuff. And, you know, a year later, we turned that project, the music from the thesis, into that project. You know, so when I was doing my defense for my master's at California State University, Sacramento, I talked about the literature, and at the end of defending my prospectus, I told them that we had a surprise for them, and I showed them the video that we had made to the song titled "Who Got the Props Off of the Project." And you know, all of these white doctors are sitting there with their white with their jaws on the table, looking at me like, "This you made this?" They say, you know, why you? Well, you know, what are you doing here? You know what I mean? Why are you here in the university? You know, so long story short, those of us that have been affected by slavery and colonialism, right? In order for us to exercise our best selves, we have to shed everything that we have inherited through the result of the Amu conquering us and colonizing us, right? We're not going to really get to our full humanity unless we do it outside, and until we do it outside of what the European has brought down on us. And in doing so, in exercising my self-determination, hip-hop, that's my culture, right? Because back to the original point, hip-hop healed me to the point where I could go back to school at Masters after working in the community through hip-hop, through the Sacramento Zulu Nation Indigenous chapter.
Excellent.
So for Lakim, for a descendant of black man, for a member of the 5% nation, for a member of the Zulu nation, right, from a working class home, from Harlem, from Watts, from Hempstead, from various places that I've stayed and I've been in Atlanta, you know, for me to exercise my full artistic freedom and my full human rights, it was through hip hop culture. And to this day, it wasn't all of that literature. It wasn't that 125-page literature that got me sitting here with y'all. It ain't what giving out this music to these kids in the street when I go and work with the kids at the schools in Oak Park, right? It's this music that connect with them, right? So when we're talking about helping our people and serving our people, and we're talking about collective work and responsibility, it's only going to be through our culture. You know what I mean? And I also look at the Meduneta, and hip hop and the lyrics of hip hop as almost an unrecognizable resurgence of us getting back to our initial language, right? Because hip hop was inspired out of Africa Bambaataa starting the Zulu Nation through his travels to the continent, right? And then coming back. So, you know, when we look at the B-boy stance, that's what we call in the 5% nation, right arm over the left. Right. When the Wu-Tang Clan came out talking about Culture Cypher, those are from our Supreme Mathematics. So hip hop in its purest form is Pan-African. Hip hop in its purest form is Black Power. This is where this knowledge, wisdom and understanding, knowledge of self. This comes out of 120 lessons.
Beautiful.
Right? I knew in order to exercise my full culture freedom, as the God said in All for One back in the day, and I ended up going to the Avalon swap meet and getting that shit tattooed on my arm when I was 18. Peace to you, God. You know what I mean? Because for all the shit that you take, you know what I'm saying? A lot of us, we joined the 5% nation because of you, great God. You know what I mean? So the healing power of hip hop, you know what I mean, is just my life's testament. You know what I mean? I come from Westside 118 Crip, right? So I had an alternative, and that was Zulu Nation. You know what I mean? That was the 5% nation. That was the power of my blackness, right? And then when we're talking about NWA, let's not forget that when Cube left NWA, he went to Hempstead, New York, and got with the Shockleys, the Bomb Squad, right? And he recreated himself through that public enemy formula. And he didn't stray to straight gangster. You look at the flip side of America's Most Wanted, half the cats on the back of the screen was from his neighborhood, from Neighborhood Crip, and the other half was from the Muhammad's mosque that he joined in Los Angeles from the Nation of Islam. So Cube was also instrumental in planting that seed in my head that real gangster was riding for your people, right? Because I was in the Rodney King riots, right? I was in Brooklyn when Yusuf Hawkins got killed. When Fight the Power came on in somebody's boombox, that's when we started breaking shit. And if you take it back, if you take it back to France Fanon in The Wretched of the Earth, he said that in order for this.
Oh, shit. What? You freaking internet. Oh, I'm being targeted. That's what it is.
Oh, that's enough. It's enough knowledge. God damn it. Now he brought out France Fanon. Oh, that's it.
We almost shut him down with talking about the Jews, but now this is it.
Motherfucker reading this shit. Oh, no. Cut them all.
Lyle be back, obviously, and he'll finish that statement. Brings up a point. Is there a difference between hip hop and rap?
I'd say so.
Yeah, I mean, raps is just a component. You know what I'm saying? I mean, you know, that's like I said. You know, rap is something you do. Hip hop is something you live. To quote KRS, you know, I mean, just is what it is. Rap is an expression of hip hop, or rap can be an expression of hip hop, but also rap can also just be rapping too. You know, guys, a lot of non hip hop ass rappers.
Yes, sir.
No doubt. Did you want to finish your point, Lyle? Because we were doing the Lord has your back. We have your back, brother. We know what's going on. Go ahead, finish your statement.
Hashtag hip hop don't stop, right? Because it never started. Knowledge is infinite. And hip hop is knowledge in its purest form, right? Whether it's the good, whether it's the bad, or whether it's the ugly that we telling, right? Hip hop just don't stop because it never started, because we know and understand that knowledge is infinite. You know, so in my view, you know, hip hop, Planet Rock have been our bridge back to the Metunetta. It's been our bridge back to our classical African language, right? Because like a lot of the people on the panel said earlier, had KRS not come with Edutainment, had the Brand Nubians not come will wake up, right? Had Rakim not come and shown us all how to be God, right? A lot of us wouldn't in 2021 be in this paradigm that we refer to as a Pan-African identity.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, right? Mm-hmm.
So when we're talking about Black people in 2021, we're everything. The descendants of Africa all over the world, we do everything. So, you know, to me, often, I think that we get caught up in, you know, trying to slice apples from oranges, but you know, like Malcolm told us in Ballad of the Bullet, you know, whether you a Black Christian or a Black Muslim, or you know, the cops is gonna whoop your ass. They don't care whether you Baptist or whether you Muslim. They just whooping your ass because you Black, right? So you know, I think that's where we are. You know what I mean? Malcolm was right in 64 when he said that, and that's still what we're seeing today. You know, whether you're Breonna Taylor, whether you're Ahmaud Arbery, whether you're Tamir Rice, whether you're George Floyd, they don't care whether you're a kid. They don't care whether you're a female. They don't care whether you're a male. They don't care if you're 4 feet tall or 14 feet tall. You know what I mean? So we're seeing a lot of confirmations to things that we've been told by those that came before us. And, you know, Professor Smalls and Kaba and Dr. Jeffries and all of that, you know, they Mfudishi, they're reminding us that, you know, the natural lineage back to the source is through the elders, and to the elders, to the ancestors, right? And to the ancestors, Ra never teshera herself, right? So, you know, hip hop is this bridge. And you know, this is why the Amu magnetized to it, because we the piece magnetic. You know what I mean? Like, we know and understand that within our teachings that we the part magnetic. So whatever we create, you know, the unalike is gonna magnetize to us. You know, so like Brother Donnelly was saying, is the lesson to take away from that, and I concur, is, you know, how are we gonna self-protect? You know what I mean? How, what we create, are we going to preserve? You know what I mean? And not allow the cultural appropriation that's occurring still to this day to keep from happening. You know, I'm blessed to manage a record shop. That's what I do for a living, to make money. I push vinyl for a living, right? And in that store, the number one spot that gets visited by people of European descent is my hip hop shelf.
Wow.
Right.
Really?
So it's constantly, so it's constantly in my head that the main consumer of hip hop music is white boys between the age of 13 to 35. You know, their girls love, why? Because their girls love us. Because their girls love it. Because we're the natural alpha male. And hip hop is one of the strongest embodiments of the alpha male that we have made.
That is a fact.
Hip hop.
That's also.
You know what I mean? Hip hop is alpha male 101-ism. You know what I mean? So you got that recessive part magnetizing to that, because them Anglo chicks, they want the tall, dark, and handsome.
That's right.
They trying to get that water back. You know, like the gravitational force of the moon on water on planet Earth. You know what I'm saying? Trying to get that water back. You know what I'm saying? So once we realize this and put that barrier, put that cipher, put that boundary on what we have, whether we make it a commodity for ourselves or not, we have to be in control of it. And I think the only way we can control it is by making the cultural components the primary components.
Love that. Love that. Go ahead, darling.
Exactly. Now, building on what Brother Law said right there, that's how we keep it under control, because that's the one thing they can't duplicate. They can't fake. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Look, right. If you're an MC, if you ever been in a cipher, you know the last thing on your mind is entertaining. You know, as soon as you start thinking about what you're saying when you freestyle, you're gonna mess up. You know what I'm saying? So it's one of these things where how we channel. That's what our ancestors did. You know, meditating. That's the ka and the ba running through us, being expressed, unfiltered. When you get in that zone and you just spitting in a cipher, you just and. That maintaining that cultural component is what will always keep us ahead. That's the reason they can always imitate what we do, but they never innovate. You know what I'm saying? Even when you take it back to something simple, I'm gonna go completely non-lyrical. Only a black man is gonna think of going, yeah, what? and know that it's gonna resonate with black people. I'm talking about Lil Jon, for example, right?
Right.
My point is, only black man is gonna come up with that. You see what I'm saying? It's like, yeah. It's because it's about that spirit. It's about knowing just what our people are going to feel. Mm-hmm. Other people are trying to copy us, but they will always, the best they can always do is duplicate. They will never be able to originate, because we got the spirit flowing through us. And the essence of MCing, at least, I'm just talking about strictly from an MCing standpoint, the epitome of it is when you freestyling, you know what I'm saying? And that spirit's just flowing through you, and you just channeling it through. You can't think about what you know. As soon as you start letting your conscious mind try to intervene, your freestyle is going to be completely, you know what I'm saying? It's going to go off. It's going to go left, you know? And that element right there, that spiritual component, you know what I'm saying, is what will always distinguish us and always keep us ahead of the curve. That's why we continue to be the creative heart and soul of the world, but especially of America.
I love it. I love this conversation, where it has gone. I love every aspect of it. The family out there is rocking with y'all right now. It is amazing, because I have to ask the question then, where is hip hop now? How do you see it manifesting for young people? I'm going to come to Dro with this, and then I'm going to go to Lord. I'm 55. I'll be 56 this year. Can somebody explain to me what the fuck is mumble rap? Can somebody help me?
Okay, I'll tell you what it is.
Just help me out. You know, I'm a little slow. Ref Shock, I can admit it. You know, I know about Metal Nature. I'm trying to fucking find out what is happening right now. What's going on? Go ahead, Dro.
It's the return of Jim Crow.
Go ahead, Dro.
I think it's the return of people having a feeling. Sometimes you don't got to say much to understand what they're saying. You know what I'm saying?
Okay.
And just like you just described when Lil Jon said, yeah, you know what I'm saying? That's more y'all era, so y'all feel that. You know what I'm saying? So now you got rappers doing similar things, but in their way. They ain't really saying nothing, but it sound tight. Same way, like, yeah, he wasn't really saying nothing, but it sound tight. I think it's just another form of that. You know what I'm saying?
Thank you, brother. See, that's why you got to have the right people around you. You know, this is my group. This is my peeps right here. I love that. Thank you, because I was lost as hell.
That's how I look at it.
There's something to be said for when it's actually original. Like, if you're the first mumble rapper, that's one thing. If you're the 29th, it's like, you got to come up with something else. You know what I'm saying? I think that's really more the issue. You know what I'm saying? You got to be original with it, you know? Again, Lil Jon saying yay is one thing, but 10 other cats after him trying to do it, it's like, you know.
Good point.
Like now that is a good point there. Because I had T.I. on my show. And when he spoke about mumble rappers, he was like, well, you know, I kind of... He gave the analogy of like a James Brown.
Mm.
He said, you ain't understand a bunch of shit that James Brown was saying. That shit was still funky as fuck. Da, 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 da. But now again, I wish I would have said what brothers said. Yeah, well, one James Brown is cool, but fucking 29 James Browns is
old. That's just how it goes. You know?
No, that ain't how it goes. That's how it goes now. See, that's how it goes now, because people would have back then, if you would have blatantly copied James Brown, people would have been like, this nigga's trying to be James Brown.
Yeah.
Just like you said, they made NWA off of whatever.
But they didn't try to sound just like
Schooly D.
See, they had elements of NWA, but they didn't have a guy that sounded, here it is, bam. They didn't have a Flavor Flav in NWA. Yeah, boy, they didn't have that. What they had was elements of what they were doing.
Didn't the old head say it sounded like a whole bunch of boom, bockety, boom, bop, 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 bop?
Listen, that's...
No,
that's
but look, that question. Yeah, I'm saying because it's now it's the same thing.
My pops didn't understand why I was using a turntable to scratch. You're going to break the turntable.
Bangity, bang, bang, and all that racket, all of that. Nice,
but that's not what we're saying. Mm-mm. That's not what we're saying. See, you're trying to act like every generation hates on the next generation.
That's
what it is. I feel like real hip hop unifies generations. Real hip hop makes my generation and your generation come together, because there's hip hop out there that we both can like, but that mumble shit is some shit that they push on younger fucking a younger demographic. And we're at a point where we're just not gonna fuck with it the way y'all fuck with it. I get why y'all might like it.
I just understand it. I feel like
And I'm not saying that I don't understand it. What we're trying to make you understand is the fact that everybody that we live in a generation now where everybody doesn't mind sounding like the next person. So we came up where you had to have your own shit.
If
you were conscious, you couldn't sound like Brand Nubian just because you wanted to be conscious. You had to find your voice. Now, you might could use little things that we're doing. You know, you might talk about, we talk about 5% shit. You might could talk about 5% shit. That's what Wu-Tang did, but they did it in a whole different way. They did it. They incorporated the fucking, the karate and all that type of shit, the karate films. Now, how whack is that if I now come and start doing that type of shit after Wu-Tang did it? Like, that's corny. But it's like at some point y'all's generation felt that what we thought was corny, meaning to copy another nigga, y'all felt like that was okay. Like somebody, and y'all wasn't the first one. It got to be somebody before us. One of us must have done it. You see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And matter of fact, let's keep it real. Let's keep it real.
Uh-oh.
Let's keep it real. I just had
to break it down. Here comes the exclusive.
A lot of people in our generation, once Tupac passed, tried to take his spot.
True that.
Mm.
True that. Real talk.
A lot of niggas kind of was rhyming in Tupac's cadence.
Yeah.
And they also tried to take his silhouette with the bald head and the fucking, you know, muscular, and I'm going to take my shirt off on stage.
Mm-hmm.
Few people did that. You know what I mean? And I'm not saying that's the first time people started copying.
Tupac
started letting that type of shit go.
Versace.
Huh?
I said Tupac.
Hey, just a quick interjection. A quick interjection. Hip hop got laws. Hip hop got laws. Hip hop got principles. Hip hop got elements. And this was established by Bambaataa through the Zulu Nation, right? The principles of hip hop are peace, love, unity, and fun. The elements of hip hop, DJing, MCing, writing a graffiti, knowledge of self, and b-boying, right? So what has fallen from generations in this millennium is the laws of hip hop. We used to have a phrase called, I'm down by law. What were the laws? Be original. No biting allowed. No biting allowed.
Right? So no biting allowed.
That was
we're talking about a law.
That was the code.
So just to pass down the laws of the culture as a student of the Zulu Nation, we have principles that have been abandoned or just not passed down like a baton. We have elements that have been abandoned or just not passed down by like a baton. And then we have laws that have either been abandoned or not passed down like a baton. Mm-hmm. And one of those main laws is no biting allowed, right? So when you got 29 motherfuckers, it's just one long video, one long song. That's the opposite of no biting allowed. That's like all we do is bite now, right? So when we talking about hip hop as a culture, right? There's rules. We understand this in the dope game. We respect this when it comes to gang banging. We respect this when it comes to the dope shit and all the shit that is non-productive for our people. You know what I'm saying? But these are the components that made hip hop make gangs stop janking and popping each other and fools to take it out with the lyrics. This is where battling came from. So when we, you know, you would never know it in the way that the battle culture had become by 2021, right? But that's what battling initially was about. It was a non-violent approach. Who started that? Bambaataa. Why? Because he came from a gang in the Bronx. He lost his friends. The movie Warriors was inspired by what was going on in the Bronx, why Bambaataa did what he did. So there was a driving force, a real driving force behind this need for non-violence. And when corporate America culturally appropriated our shit, they could give a fuck if we killing each other, just like the guy said earlier. So is this truly self-expression, or is this us being victims of hyper-exploitation? And one thing I also want to say, being an advocate, a student of history, I can't help but when I look at some of these images and hear some of these sounds today, to have come to my head the Jim Crow story. And in the Jim Crow story, there's some main characters. There's the Jezebel, there's the Buck, there's the Uncle Tom, there's the Mammy, and there's Sambo. And when we look at the main images of black people in media across the board, like y'all said earlier, not just in the music, but in the movies and the BET TV shows or the CBS TV shows or the UPN TV shows, we're still seeing those main same characters from the Jim Crow minstrel show.
That is so true.
Seeing basically the Tom, the Me, the Jezebel, the Buck, and Sambo.
Wow. Make it Rev Shock want to cuss. So, this is great.
I think,
again. Go ahead, Billy.
He's making some
good points. Fuck the system, I'll curse for you. Fuck the system, champ Babylon down. I'll curse for you, right? So when people don't know their history, they're doomed to repeat it. And in many ways, that's what we're going through right now, is we're repeating history, because much to not fault of our own, through the system, through public education, we don't really know our history in whole. We know our history episodically. We know our history in episodes. And like Brother Donnelly did, it puts together a greater narrative and a greater perspective, you know what I'm saying, of what exactly it is we're dealing with. Have we really come that far? Or are we like rats or hamsters on a wheel kind of running in place? You know what I mean? Bob Marley called that rat race. He had a song about it called Rat Race.
Real talk. Billy Bird, your thoughts on that, and then we're going to wind it down and close it out. Go ahead, bro.
Some real power points there, because old school was a code. No biting allowed. That was known, and actually the pressure, the community would not allow you to bite.
Mm-hmm.
If you got up there and did something that somebody else was doing, you wouldn't allow, you weren't even allowed to get up there. You'd be booed. You might get jacked, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So where we are today, which is interesting, is and I love where La went, because there's some pieces and I want to stop and say we should have given some respect to the female side of our rappers and the Queen Latifahs and MC Lights and those folks who mm-hmm. did their thing to pave the way for those that come after. But what La was saying, it resonates with me, because we got to get control of our culture. Because for me, and you know, I'm into men's ministry. When I look at the male masculine energy that I'm starting to see infiltrate the rap game, and I'm not going to name any specific rappers, you know, and the attire that they're wearing and stuff like that, that's unacceptable, because that actually affects our generation of young men coming up. Go ahead, Lord. I got to let Lord in.
I saw the look. I know, because I talked to Lord about this. And you say you don't want to mention any names. You can talk about Lil Nas. I mean, let's just bring it up, bring it out. There's some shit that's going on.
Man, I don't represent it.
Yeah, that cat's a pure product.
Go
that
ahead.
Cat's a
pure product. No, everybody. Go ahead. So
no, you can say that, Lil Nas.
All I want to say is, because I got to get ready to get out of here in a minute, but all I want to say is that the title of this is, can hip-hop, what is that, save our youth or something? Is that what it is?
Save African-Americans. Heal African-Americans.
Save African-Americans, and my answer is not this motherfucking hip-hop we got today. Like, I'm going to keep it real. I'm sorry. I'm sorry, young Dro. I'm not trying to shit on your generation. But, you know, it's y'all not dealing with the same morals and codes and type of, they've conditioned y'all much differently. So a lot of y'all don't care. Like again, when in my interview with T.I., he would have said that when we talked about no biting allowed, he said, well, what about the rappers that just, you know, they're just trying to feed their family and they don't even care about hip hop. They're just doing it to make money so that they can not be starving and all that type of shit. And that's the thing, you know what I mean? But at the same time, then do another genre. If you want to just make music, then do another genre of music that doesn't involve laws and principles. You see what I'm saying? Why don't you go do rock music?
Who created these laws you guys are speaking of?
The people that created hip hop.
No, but nobody following them though now.
And that's fucked up.
That's why, that's
why y'all are doomed. That's why y'all are not going to be able to save.
We're the most influential group on the planet right now.
Right. You know? Influencing people.
Influential
what?
Yeah, exactly.
Get money.
What?
I'm saying, get money, be entrepreneur.
Your man is your man right now. Right, influencing niggas to fucking lap dance the devil. What the fuck are you talking about?
Black people are doing things right now. What the fuck I'm talking about? The entrepreneurial spirit is really.
And that's what rappers are influencing.
I'm saying
so rappers are getting on there. Financial literacy. That's what you're telling me.
I'm saying you're giving them the credit of leadership, right? And a lot of us are becoming more financially literate. And a lot of the teachers are hip-hop, straight up. Mm-hmm. The ones that are teaching us are hip-hop. Yes,
and they're from our era.
The teachers in hip-hop
are from our era.
The young people nowadays are rich. They listen to rap music, bro, that are inspiring. Go watch Social Proof. There's nobody your age there.
If I could jump in as the OG.
In hip-hop right now?
If I could jump in as the OG.
Hip-hop right now. What are they talking about in hip-hop?
There's so many different messages, bro. You feel me? Now, what do you listen to? I don't know. You might want to turn the station. Everybody can do that.
What are the main ones?
Everybody can turn the station.
Hold on, Joe.
You sound like so fucking mainstream. Everybody can turn the station. Like,
yeah. You can turn the station, bro.
That's a real corny answer.
We about to do a reality show up in here. Billy Bird, what's going on? As the elder in the room.
I've heard those answers for you.
If I could step in with just a little bit of OG status, since I'm probably
please, OG.
Look, one of the things that I don't want us to do is go at each other because we both are right and we probably both are wrong. And there are some good things about everything that we do in this genre. And then there's things that we need to clean up. But the one thing I definitely want to make sure that we do is stay connected.
Absolutely.
We cannot afford to be disconnected, bro.
And to be able to have this kind of discourse and dialogue, but still love each other and come together as one.
Right.
Because that's the other thing is that we have let some generations down. And each time we end up, blaming the previous generation or blaming the new generation or judging the new generation. And that shit is just not cool.
So I think with that though, it is important to put things into context for if we both been here for 2 hours and somebody comes into the chat room, we got to bring them up to speed on how we got to where we are, because they weren't here for the last 2 hours, what I mean? And so if you haven't been here for the last 30 years of hip hop, I got to bring you up to speed on kind of how we got to where we are. And, so it's not necessary. So I think the important thing, though, too, though, is that to understand that again, this is the entertainer versus artist conversation, because Dro's talking more from the perspective, like you said, business, entrepreneurialism, these kind of things. As an artist, and again, I didn't talk about my background in hip hop. I had a live hip hop band for 17 years. We toured the Roots, KRS-One was on my last album. Played with Tribe Called Quest, played with a lot of people. I was on Jill Scott's first tour, so I had an extensive music career. Toured Brazil, toured England. I did my thing on that. But what was important to me was to always remain an artist. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? To always be contributing to the art form for its own intrinsic value. And to me, the billions and billions of dollars that hip hop makes still pales. That value still compares. Pales in comparison to its intrinsic value as art. You know what I'm saying? Like, how much is the genre of jazz worth?
Mm-hmm.
How many billions is jazz worth? Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Come on. There's no price. Mm-hmm. There's no price for hip hop. So the fact that we are selling out our culture, our art form for any amount of money, to me, is just not worth it. We have to have at least a strong element. There needs to be there needs to be that element that still preserves the integrity of the art as art. There needs to be an element within hip hop where, look, back in the 90s, you remember that it didn't matter how many Grammys you had. If you had 5 mics in the Source, you could have 0 sales. If your joint had 5 mics in the Source, it was official.
You're super. Right.
That's true.
You see what I'm saying? We had our own standard, our own bar, and that was the bar that mattered. It didn't matter how many, what didn't matter about sales, it didn't matter about Grammys, it was all about respect. You had a quotable in the Source, you had, 4.5-5 mics. That was the goal as an MC. I mean, if you're putting out a record, now it's trying to adhere to somebody else's standard, it's trying to get the Grammy. Grammy's so white and all this other nonsense. I ain't studying it, It's like, we've allowed corporate America to infiltrate our own standard, and now we're trying to live up to somebody else's standard. And like my brother said, he's like, and reasonably so, Dro's like, what are these laws? I ain't heard, who's even enforcing these things?
Mm-hmm.
But it's because they're not enforced. It's because they're not respected and it hasn't been passed down generationally. What's happened is the young generation doesn't even understand why there should be some value in that. So it's like, why keep jazz around? Who cares about you? Why keep classical music around? I'm just going to do what sells.
And all of that is part of the divide.
Everything has laws. That's what's so crazy. Like,
cartel
drugs. There's laws to that shit. So let's not act like, where these laws come from. Right. Like, laws exist with everything. Without laws, there's anarchy. So that's what they want to create in hip-hop now. They want it to be hip-hop anarchy. You can just do whatever the fuck you want, and it doesn't matter because you're making money and you're being an entrepreneur. No, it does fucking matter. And this
matters.
Trying to teach that.
I agree there should be
some. Hold up. Like, real quick. Like just like he said, if you just come in the chat just now, we've been talking for 2 hours, right? Maybe there's a rule. We had a rule where we don't talk over each other, right?
Mm-hmm.
You come in here talking over niggas, singing and shit, fucking, doing whatever the fuck you want to do in the chat. Like, that's not cool, Dro.
Right.
because you've been here these past 2 hours. And so you might be one of the main, yo, chill, bro. We in here like we've been doing it like this the whole time. You can't just come up in here changing up the chat.
Hold on, bro. I gotta wind it down and I gotta end it here, fam. Let me do this. Give us Brian, what are you up to currently? How can people get in contact with you?
Oh, what am I up to? I just finished I guess I'll drop it now. Actually, I have two playlists on Spotify that I dedicated to you, Philippe, and actually Lord Jamar. You gave me the title for one, and that is Shocked Miss Prime. and then based off of that, I did another playlist called The Alchemist. And Brand Nubian, Lord Jamar, everybody, all old school hip hop, 80s, 90s, maybe a little 2000s, but mainly 80s, 90s. And on both of those playlists, those is probably about 7 or 8 hours worth of music. So just pop it in, let it go, and stop. Philippe knows about the Shock Miss Prime one because he got that for his birthday.
Lord Jamar messed me up for life.
That's a dope alias, son.
We take it all around the world. And I also just finished a 7-volume set that I dedicated to Professor Kaba Hiawatha Kamene. I call it Kaba Grooves. I think the first 3 volumes are public on Spotify. So just look up Jazzy Beano and just punch in Kaba Grooves or punch in Shocked Miss Prime. I guess it'll all come up. But I did a 7-volume set for Kaba because that's his favorite number. And it's just music that I feel that I'm inspired by, but at just hearing conversations and talking to Kaba, you know, that good 60s, 70s, 80s, just mess music and funk. And it's about 20 hours worth of music or so. So it's 7 volumes. Once again, you just run with it and look at it up under Spotify.
Fantastic. Thank you for that, Brother B. Lau, what you got going? What's coming? What you working on? And how can people get in contact?
Right now, we're working on the front. Well, you can get in contact with us at underdogmusic713 at IG. Please, everybody that's in tune with this, go and check our latest project out for free and free download. Feel free to make a donation if you like. It's Underdog's Manifesto. Currently, we're working on a follow-up to Underdog's Manifesto. It's called Underdog's Power Cosmic. It's going to be featuring Kaba and Shocked Miss Prime. And, you know, we'll be bringing that to y'all in the fall of this year. And in the meanwhile, look out for our latest video release that we're going to be putting out in a couple of weeks called Zelzala. So we just making more music. Hip hop don't stop.
Beautiful. Beautiful. Darnley.
Still got the American Lowe's film, The American Legacy of White Supremacy, out on Amazon. So check that out if you haven't already, or go to theamericanlowe's.com. Also just finished the 4-part series for BET Digital right here on YouTube. Go to BET's YouTube channel, watch The Breakdown, wrote and produced 4 episodes talking about everything from ancient Kemet to the Maroons, to where Black people get our sense of cool from, to Black English. And just trying to change some minds, man, and influence some people and put out some information that folks ain't getting necessarily in the mainstream. So
phenomenal.
Follow me on IG. I just changed my name there. You can follow Brother Sankara on Instagram. That's my Instagram. So, you know, follow me on that. Yeah.
Excellent. Thank you, Brother. Lord Jamar, what you up to? I need some Brand Nubian, man. I need it in my life, man. What's going on?
I don't know. Yeah. Installed. I don't know what's going on. We started some shit and I don't know what happened. But yeah, you know, you could check me out on YouTube, you know what I mean? Godcast, check us out there. You could subscribe.
You're on Patreon as well, right?
We on Patreon now with the exclusive live. So we do our stream yard over there now. So if you want to be a part of the chat and all that, you have to be a subscriber. But we still put out episodes on YouTube, but we just do the live over there on Patreon. You could also check me out on this next season coming up on The Last OG, Tracy Morgan show.
Oh, really? Oh, I can't wait. When is that coming out? I love that.
I'm not sure. They're filming right now. And,
oh, fantastic.
I have a reoccurring character by the name of Divine.
Paige.
Yeah.
Nice. Love that.
I just shot an episode of that.
Love that. One love, Lord. Dro, how can people get in contact with you? And what are you up to right now?
Well, you can get in contact with me on social media, Young Get a Dro. On Instagram, it's spelled that way, but you would have to put an underscore in front of the Young Get a Dro. I currently cut hair in Sacramento, 1601 Fulton is my barbershop. I'm currently moving into my clothing store on 2737 Fulton right now. And pretty much you could just kind of follow me. I've kind of been documenting my process or whatever, going, you know, trying to make it, you feel me, on YouTube. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? You can check me out on YouTube, Instagram, Snapchat, you know what I'm saying? Or pull up on me on my part of the business. And I also breed dogs, XL Pit Bull Terriers.
Ooh, that's what's up. I fuck with the pits.
Yeah, man. So, yeah, I got the best pit from Northern California. They win in all the shows. So check me out, man.
Nice. I'm going to have to come and see what you can do with my hair, man. See what you can do as a barber. Brother B-Man. What you got going on?
Oh, yeah. Don't make me get my dog.
We got a pit off is what we got.
But don't make me get my dog.
Y'all are crazy.
Hey, I bet you there's some laws when it comes to breeding them dogs. I bet you he got some laws he go by there.
Oh, Lord, you are.
Hip hop don't stop.
Oh, okay. That's a boy or a girl?
It's the boy.
Okay. My boy's name is Anubis. Oh, that's the girl right
there. This is Ampu.
They got the same name. Oh, snap.
Anubis and Ampu.
That's crazy.
That's crazy.
That's crazy.
My last dog name was Newbie. That was short for Anubis.
Wow.
See how hip hop makes us kiss and make up? That's just beautiful right there. That's what I'm talking about.
The healing power of hip hop.
The healing power of hip hop just happened right before our eyes.
Hold up. Now. You training too? Do you train?
I mean, I train them, you know what I'm saying? My dog. Right. So this is my first year really going hard with it, going to try to go to the shows.
Oh, yeah. That fucks with the training shit. I'm like a little.
Okay, yeah. We're going to have to link up there for sure.
Yeah.
There's some rules to go with that, though. I just got to warn you.
You said, it's good.
The rules you got to follow when you get
I didn't tell wasn't with the rules.
It's the rules you got to follow when you bring your dog.
Y'all going to be in the chat offline.
You don't even know. I bet you're sitting in the dog.
Man, Billy Bird. What you got?
Dog's mouth. Who told you about that? Spitting
what?
In the mouth. You ever spit in a dog's mouth?
Oh, no, I don't spit in my dog's mouth. I don't know about that.
Yeah, that's an old school dog training shit or whatever.
Oh, yeah.
Went to a whole nother you know, I feel like Oprah right now. We're talking about a whole other goddamn thing now. What the fuck? What just happened? The shock to his pride. Brother B-Man, what you got going, brother?
I'm glad to see that the two brothers end the way they did, because we got people that seeing this and watching that, and that's black power. That's love.
Yeah, real talk.
I look up to Lord Jamar, so you already know.
No doubt. And really,
disagreement doesn't mean hate, brother.
Some people take it that way. And the great thing.
And this is beautiful that we're seeing brothers being able to have a conversation versus a competition. That's important.
And Philippe knows that's what we do, you know, in our industry. We strengthen each other. Iron sharpens iron. Men being able to be men, transparent, be able to buck up against each other, but know that we got each other's back. And so I love that. Appreciate everybody on the panel. I'm working, hopefully in the next month, we should have the book, The Black Room, out for everybody. Please support that for me. I really hope that
I'm writing the forward.
Change some men's lives. Everyone's life, really, men and women. Also, working on some affirmations for Black men and Black women. And so we just continue to try to further help the culture, help clear our minds up, help fight against colonialism, whiteism, whatever you want to call it. We looking to just make a change. We feel that right now there's a shift happening, you know, as we've come into this new generation of Aquarius, you know, something is in the water. And you brothers tonight are proof of that, because every one of y'all brings something unique and special that I know I need and the world needs.
Facts. So
thank y'all.
And I want to thank you for that, Brother B-Man. I want to thank all of you, because all of you have changed my life. I love you to pieces. I got you. I got your back. And thank you for your contribution to the culture and what you're doing and what you have done and what you will continue to do for the culture moving forward. Community, thank you so much for tuning in. Thank you for the dialogue. Thank you for the chat. Some of you out there, love you so much. There's too many names to mention. There's too many people watching. But I love you. Make sure you like, share, subscribe. Make sure you support these brothers in all of their endeavors. And as you already know, what I'm going to say, and that is, I'll see you next time on the Philippe Matthews Show Live. Hotep community, peace.